Hello and welcome to Between the Lines, our podcast here at Victory Hill, where we step back and look at Sunday's message. I'm your host, Chris Varnell, and I have Pastor Aaron with us today. Yes. And we're going to jump into it here in a few minutes.
Yes. But,
wow. I was thinking today, as I was looking at my calendar, like Sunday's the 1st of October.
It is the 1st of October.
And the first Sunday of October.
Yeah, but I'm liking a little bit of the cooler weather, but not too cool. You know,
this is
if I'm not by the beach somewhere, this is like the prime weather for me, you know, like
you
70s
go.
And can be outside a little bit and watching soccer games or football games or something along that.
Yeah.
So, but and at night, I mean, I need a bonfire pit at my house because it's just getting a little bit cooler, and I don't want one though. I have to actually do the bonfire. I want one of those gas ones though.
Yes. I was just going to say
the ease of use.
You really should get just the gas pit because then you don't have the smoke smell. You don't have all that stuff to deal with.
The problem is if I get a gas one though, and I have that in my backyard, I'm going to want s'mores all the time. And that's probably not healthy for me either, you know? So it's like, you know, it's this kind of this tension, that you feel in those moments. So
I like this
time of year. I love the fall, you know, as we kind of get into it and stuff like that.
I do too. Except that you never know how to dress in the mornings.
Yes. That is the challenge with like the kids.
You put the jackets on and then it's like, no, it's too hot. And then it's, you know, back and forth and stuff, but you have to kind of figure that all out.
Do you have any fall traditions that you enjoy or anything that you go to or any of that kind of stuff?
We usually try to go to some type of pumpkin farm, you know, just to hang out. We went to a really fun one up off of 37 a year or so ago. That was really a new one and we really liked it. It was fun. Kids really enjoyed it. We enjoyed it. So, but we like to take in one of those, you know, and stuff like that a little bit. So
always something new that you can kind of do in the fall and stuff like that. And we have Fall Fun Fest even like as a church.
And
that's always a fun activity for everybody to come out and be a part of. So,
I was thinking, that's what I was thinking about. I said, man, I got to really start promoting that because it's October 23rd.
Yes.
On Saturday afternoon, we'll have a great time.
Yes, but, it will be. Yep.
Another beautiful day like this.
We keep our fingers crossed and hope that's the case.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. I also like all the fall goodies.
Okay.
Like I love apples and caramel and stuff like that. So, you know,
I'm always just a little disappointed this time of year though, because the apple orchards, like they're just not around here like they were in Michigan.
Oh, really?
And so so there's like an apple orchard everywhere and you can go in and get the hot donuts and cider and it's awesome.
Yeah.
And so it's always just kind of fun to do that. So usually if we can get up to Michigan in the fall, I mean, we have to hit an apple orchard and get some of those cinnamon donuts and some apple cider.
Mm.
Nothing better.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And then, of course, we'll have pumpkin show.
The pumpkin show. Yes.
And the pumpkin donuts.
The pumpkin donuts are good. But I will say I think I lean towards the hot cinnamon ones from the apple orchard a little bit more.
Wow.
I know like that may be like cast out of here because like
speaking
against the pumpkin donuts at the. But the cinnamon ones.
I just don't think we've had them.
You see, I think that's the problem, you know? So I'm going to have to bring some back sometime. The problem is that you eat like a bunch of them though when you get them though. You can't just stop at one, you know? Like it's like, you know, so it's not, if you go to the orchard every day, you'll be in trouble. So
That's exactly right.
It's got to be a treat, so.
Well, good. Well, yes, I am just looking forward to fall. And I'm looking forward to talking today about kingdom mindset, which was our third presentation on the kingdom culture.
Yep.
And I really, I thought when I was listening to what you were saying and I thought, you know, mindset is just such a powerful thing.
It is.
I'm one of these people that occasionally I kind of do this dieting thing.
Okay.
But I can't do it if my mind's not in the right place.
Exactly.
I mean, I have to make sure my mind is the right place. And I've been thinking a lot about it lately because I really need to. But I'm like, nope, my mind's not there. My mind's not there. But yet, relating that to our faith walk and our the kingdom culture, I was like, that was eye-opening to me.
Yeah.
So,
Well, you know, we kind of said Sunday that, you know, our mindset is so important when it comes to the kingdom of God, because some of the greatest battles that we face, I mean, it's right here. You know, it's us getting over some of the things that have either happened in our life or that are going on in our life and saying, hey, I'm going to change kind of the mindset in which I'm going to approach this with. And I'm going to really learn what it looks like to have kind of that mindset for the kingdom of God. And I think it's just really important. And, you know, and I think what we see throughout scripture is we can win the battles that come against our mind, you know, and that we are opposed by an enemy. And, you know, the Bible says we don't fight against flesh and blood, but sometimes what we're fighting against, fighting against ourselves, you know, and the thoughts and the ideologies and the things that we're being influenced with in the everyday world that we live in, you know.
Yeah.
And so it's important.
Well, and you made a really good distinction on that earthly mindset and that heavenly mindset.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes we always want to know that heaven is there and heaven is where we're going and all that kind of stuff. But we don't actually focus on the fact that that heavenly mindset is really just also part of our whole reflection of Christ. But the worldly mindset was interesting. And, you know, it is easy to become world dependent. You said.
Yeah. Yeah, and it is. I mean, we so fall into the patterns that, you know, this world is going to be the thing that's going to provide me everything that I need. It's going to provide me, you know, the happiest that I need and all these types of things. And so we begin to fall into those patterns and the mindset that says, this is all that there is to life. This is how life is always going to be, or this is how it's going to work. And we just begin to get into that everyday grind. And then our minds begin to get set on those things. And scripture is very clear. Like, we're not to set our mind on things below. We're to set our minds on things above.
Yeah.
And so, you know, so we've got to have a different mindset than what this world offers us.
Yeah. And I think the other thing is that you said was that in this worldly mindset, we can get addicted to pleasure. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, we go through life here, and I've heard so many people say this to me, isn't it okay for me to have joy?
Yeah.
Isn't it okay for me to have a little happiness in my life, especially when they're going through hard times and stuff? Yeah. And it's like, you know, that's not the number one thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. You know, and so I think, you know, the three things that we talked about that are kind of this worldly mindset, one of them was the fact that we get just addicted to the pleasure. And it's like, okay, I just want to be happy. I just want the here and now and in this moment. And it's a very short-sighted mindset. You know, it's like, hey, what do I got to do right now to bring this happiness? And and that becomes the mindset of the world. You know, we indulge in the pleasure. We indulge in the things that the world is offering us. And we get so distracted from the kingdom of God and from the mindset that Christ has come to give us in that. We said, you know, that another part of the worldly mindset is we become unaware of the benefits of the cross. And honestly, this is why, I mean, even we see, I was thinking about Paul's conversion when he all of a sudden decided, hey, I'm no longer going to be, you know, this individual. He was Saul beforehand, and he has this encounter with God. And God comes to him, and I think it's in Acts like 26:18, and he says, now I'm going to send you to him, and I want you to preach the good news of the gospel, and you're going to help open their eyes. And what was he talking about? He was telling, you're going to help change the mindset. They're going to become aware of the gospel, the cross of Christ Jesus. And so all of us at one point or another were blinded or unaware of the benefits of the cross. And the difference between us and the people of the world is now we're aware of the grace and the mercy and the joy and the happiness and the fruit of the Spirit that are available to us. But when we have a worldly mindset, we don't see the benefits of it. And so therefore, we're not pursuing those things. And that's where we just have to, you know, if you know people or you're that person that goes, man, I'm unaware of the benefit. That's where we just start asking God, open the eyes of my heart. Help me to have a different mindset. You know, unlock the promises of who you are and what your word says to us in that moment.
Right. So, that's good. That's good. Yeah. You know, and you said too that I wouldn't, you know, that sometimes part of that mindset is looking in the wrong places for what you need in life. And, you know, I loved that, you know, you went to Dick's to buy Abby a birthday present. But, you know, it's so true though, you know, and you look at this world and you look at the people who do not have that kingdom mindset, that they're looking for happiness and they're looking for things everywhere they can find them, but they're all in the wrong places.
Yeah. And you're never going to, you know, I think that, you know, that was the whole illustration. Like, hey, if I go to this place, I'm never going to find this thing that, you know, maybe that you set out to find, because they're never going to be able to offer those things, you know?
Yeah.
And sometimes we're looking for things and sometimes it's not even in bad places, but they're just never going to be able to fulfill that, you know? And I even tell people that as far as even in relationships sometimes, you know, like, hey, I'm looking towards a spouse to fulfill something. I mean, well, guess what? It's never going to be that. Like, you're going to be fulfilled in your relationship with Christ, and then he brings these benefits along, you know? And so there's different places that we go thinking, hey, this is going to be the answer, but they're all the answers that the world can only try to provide. And so we search after those things, and yet you're going to continue to come up empty time and time again, because you will never find that unless you're going to the one who can provide it for you in the beginning.
And you said that, you know, that you can't look for things that only God can provide anywhere but in him. So yeah, that's good. And then we talked, you talked about that Paul really warned us to not conform to the pattern of this world. And I can't remember you, I think you, did you give us a definition of conform?
Was that one? I did not on that one.
Okay. No, it was another word that, but yeah, I mean, if we try to fit into this world, that's what I kind of think conform, you know,
exactly.
I think you take something, you pour it in and it conforms to the, whatever vessel you've put it in or whatever.
Exactly.
If you try to conform to this world, you know, it's going to take every bit of you, including your mind and everything. So,
and that's what, I mean, that's what this world does to us. It the goal probably of the world in which we live is to get us just to conform to it. You know, it's just to kind of go along with it and to go, okay, this is just how it is. And, you know, and yet to live in the kingdom of God, it is that recognition that we've been talking about every week that I'm not of this world, you know, that I'm from a different place. And so the world is always going to try to get you to conform. It's always going to try to get your mindset set on something that isn't the things that God has for you. And so we got to be very guarded about that. And I think the insight or the wisdom or the reason that we always talk about the fact that the word of God is alive and active, because we know this, like this is so true because we've experienced this all the time, a world that is trying to get us to conform to their values, to their mindsets, to their ways of thinking, to their way of doing things. And yet the Bible says, don't do it. Like, don't do it. Like, God has a good and pleasing and perfect will for you. And it may not look like the things that this world wants to offer you, but it is so much better when we kind of fall to his patterns.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, we as far as the church as a whole, we're struggling right now, I think, to really understand how we make those differential pieces of conforming to the world and being a part of this. And even the church as a whole, I think that we need to be reminded, don't follow after the patterns of this world. Yeah. And it's been a challenging season for that.
It's been a very challenging season to that, you know, and how do we walk that out a little bit and how do we honor God in the midst of it, you know? And yet I think when we start looking at what that looks like, we've got to be very careful that we don't just take a single, I mean, this is all of life, but I've seen it a lot probably in the last like year, you know, we can't just take one scripture and try to, you know, lay it over everything. You know, we've got to take the whole word of God. I mean, that's what we talk about, the whole word of God. It's all good. And say, okay, how does all of these pieces come together then to kind of form this worldview, or how do I respond in the midst of a world that's trying to get me to conform to it? You know?
Yeah.
And sometimes though, we've taken that out of context a little bit and we're fighting against some things that I'm not so sure that it would be the very things that God would say, hey, that's what I was talking about. Don't do this. You know, I think he's going, hey, there's patterns and behaviors that I don't want you to conform to in your life.
And Paul said to us, he told us, he said, let's change your focus.
Yeah. Yep.
Change your focus a little bit, you know, and I like the idea that you taught, you narrowed it down to two things, knowing Christ and becoming more like Christ.
Yes. Yeah.
And that is those are the two keys to having the mindset that you need to have.
Yeah. And this was Paul's mindset, you know, so as we're doing this book study through Philippians, what we begin to see is, you know, who Paul is even just clearer and, you know, how he encourages the church. And he's like, hey, I just want you to know, like, my goal in my life is to know him. And what I see so much there is the contrast of Paul's life. Like before he knew Christ, it was about his success. It was about his own religious opinion. It was about the things that was going to make him happy that he thought he was supposed to do. It was about religion and prestige and honor. Everything that our world tells us, hey, go after, like you should go after these things. And yet he says, now that I've experienced the benefits of the cross, I know who Christ is and I'm no longer a citizen of this world. Like my only goal is to know him and to become like him. And I do think it begins to simplify the process. Like, okay, what is my goal? It's to know God and to become more like him, you know?
Yeah.
And I think everything can begin to fit under those categories to go, I just want to become more like him and I want to know him more each and every day of my life.
Yeah. And you know, it just kind of reminds you of that remember, you maybe you were too young, but the what would Jesus do thing, you know,
oh, no.
I mean,
yeah.
It just, you know, I mean, it was basically, if you know him well enough, you're going to do what he says to
exactly.
do, you know, and I think that that's what we all should be striving for. And, you know, and you said that we should arrange our lives for and achieve his goals for us. Then you gave us four things that we need to, and it all dealt with perspective.
Yeah.
And I love to think about perspective, and mm-hmm. I love to try to help people see a different perspective. Yeah. That's kind of one of the things that I you know, if you're really, let's turn it around a little bit.
Yep.
I'm one of those, you know, I'm the glasses half full person.
Okay.
So, and Mike is the glasses half empty.
Okay. Yep.
So we are challenged with perspective sometimes,
yeah.
you know, of whose perspective are we going to look at this from,
yeah.
you know, but you looked at priorities. Mm-hmm. That we have to, first of all, make sure we've got the proper perspective of our priorities.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, you know, we got to look at, you know, what is foundational to our lives, you know, is the true priority of our every area of our lives to know and become like Jesus, you know? And so if that's the filter we're running it through, how are we arranging our lives around achieving this goal? You know, so that's what we were saying, like, how do we arrange our lives around it? And so Paul would say things to us like, hey, you need to make sure you have the proper priorities in your life. You know, he says, I press on towards the goal. Like I know what my goal is. And now because I know the goal, now everything's going to filter around that. And so if we are people that are lacking purpose or lacking you know, what the goal is, guess what? Our priorities aren't going to be right. Mm-hmm. And I do think we live in a world, in a day, in an age, in a time where it's like our priorities are out of line. And then we're wondering why life isn't quite functioning the way that we hope to. It's because we've fallen into like an earthly mindset of going, hey, I got to go after these things. These things
exactly.
are what become the priorities of my life.
Right.
And it's got to switch, you know? And so we just need to begin to look through our life and go, hey, is the priority of my life to know and become like Christ? And if it's not, what areas of my life am I lacking in that? And what am I going to do about that? You know? And so it's the recognition that, hey, my priorities are out of line. I got to change some things. And it's healthy, you know? And so so that new perspective becomes a mindset, you know, it becomes the mindset to go, hey, I got to do this differently. And here's how I need to begin to arrange my life to know and become like Christ.
I think about that when I've had some conversations recently with people and just even with their children.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, what is your priority for mm-hmm. your child? Is your priority really for your child to become an all-star baseball player?
Yeah. Yeah.
Or is your priority for your child to know Christ Jesus and make his way to heaven?
Yeah.
You know, because sometimes that gets really messy in there.
It does.
And I think that sometimes we have, you know, it is very much an earthly mindset in that I want my kid to succeed. I see talent. I see abilities. Whatever. I want to do everything I can to, mm-hmm. you know, but then you're like, but what are you sacrificing on the backside of it? And so evaluating those priorities all across the board and keeping that focus so clearly
knowing Christ. You know, and it's so easy to fall into the other mindset. And I think that's the key is sometimes it feels like it's a very fine line, you know, mm-hmm. between the two. And it's kind of like, how do we walk that a little bit? But you know, if we're gonna err on the side of, hey, I'm working to know and become like Jesus, you know, and go, that's got to be the number one. And so then what can we do off of this? And I think God will help us navigate those things. I do think it's challenging when it comes to our kids, you know, because, you know, the goal, you know, sometimes our goal is, hey, I want to give my best to my kids, where the goal really should be. You see, and that's the problem is that it's not the priority. Like the giving your best to the kids isn't the goal is like, how am I helping them become and know Jesus more?
Yeah.
And so if I'm doing that, guess what? You're giving them the best. And I think as we see through scripture and just everything else, when we honor God in that, then God begins to bless in ways that we can never imagine.
Yeah. Like last week we talked mm-hmm. about obedience brings blessing.
It is.
Right.
Yep.
So, and then you talked about have the proper perspective of the present.
Yeah.
And you used the term that you haven't, if you think that you've arrived, you haven't arrived.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, it's so true. And sometimes we arrive and we just sit.
Yeah.
And other times we just think we've arrived and there's nothing anybody can teach us.
So. I think it's the recognition of where am I currently at, you know? And this is just something I think as, you know, followers of Christ or wherever, if you're not even a follower yet, like what's my current situation? What's my current, you know, my present state of being mm-hmm. in the sense of, you know, and my relationship with Christ. And so the problem when I say that is like, if you think you've arrived, like that's going to be an issue because none of us have, you know?
Right.
And when you think you've arrived, you slow down, you stop doing things. You think there's nothing more to learn. There's no more room to grow. But the goal, we got to remember the goal. The goal is to know and to become like Christ. And so there's something more I should know about him. And there's probably areas of my life I need to become like him in. And so I can't act like I've just arrived. And if we act like we arrived, we'll stop investing. We'll stop growing. We'll stop learning. And that's not what God wants for us, you know?
Yeah.
And so have a proper perspective of the present. And so I think the best way, you know, and you kind of mentioned, you know, on Sunday, even as I was teaching, I was thinking of that WWJD bracelet, you know, is this comparison side of it, of taking our lives and putting it up to the life of Christ. And I'll just be honest, like, it may be even a difficult thing because we're going to realize all of our shortcomings, you know, and maybe that's even hard to recognize sometimes. It's in the shortcomings, though, that he says, my grace is sufficient for you. And so hopefully seeing our shortcomings also kind of brings back the realization, his grace is sufficient for me. This is a God who loves me and cares about me and wants the best for me. But, you know, I'm not living up in these areas. So what do I got to do to become more like Christ? Whether that's in your marriage, whether that's in your parenting, whether that's in your career, whether, you know, whatever it is that you're doing, how do I compare? How do I live up? And I'm going to have a proper perspective of where I currently am. And we are all a work in progress. And I think that's the thing that we have to remember over and over again.
You know, the other day we had our ladies group, and one of the ladies brought up the fact, and she said, you know, we were reading through a portion of scripture, and we were talking about how it speaks differently to you at different times. And I think that, and she said, you know, that's why it's the living word, you know, so we've never arrived, because even if we go right back to the Bible, God's word is alive and actually there for us at different times with different messages and stuff. And so keeping present in that and realizing that, you know what, hey, I've read this 100 times, but I never saw that.
Exactly.
Well, that's why God wants you to see it. He wants to challenge you with that or whatever. So it was so good. The other thing was maintaining a proper perspective of the past. And this is a challenge, you know, for people that have had a difficult past, of not always just feeling like that they carry this around with them.
Yeah.
But at one point you said in your message, I may have baggage, but I'm not living out of it.
Yeah.
And I thought, what a great visual to, you know, hey, the baggage sits over there. I got it still, and I've dealt with it, but I don't go back and dig through it and live through it again.
Yeah.
So
I almost thought about bringing a suitcase out on Sunday, honestly,
you know, like a good time.
Because I mean, that was kind of the picture that, like, I was seeing in my head there, is that let's just, all of us have some baggage, you know, we've got a past, you know, and Paul, who writes this, had more baggage than anybody else. And, you know, and when we talk about forgetting about it, you know, it, in this earthly sense, it is, you know, we can't just take an erase. We don't have amnesia.
Right.
And so it's not just gone, you know, and I think that's the hard part, you know, because we say, forget about your past. Well, Aaron, what I'm thinking about, like this is a part of my life. Like, how do I forget? Well, it's about not living out of it. It's a, it's there, and there's baggage over there, but that's been covered under the grace of God. That doesn't define my future going forward, you know? And I think if you do that eventually, I think that baggage is going to feel further and further away from you. In the here and now, sometimes it feels really close because maybe you were just in it yesterday, you know?
But
you know, you put it away and go, I'm not living out of this anymore. You know, this isn't going to define me. This is going to be what I'm putting on every day, because I'm a child of God, and I'm not going to allow the past to define my future.
Well, and God is recreating you.
Yeah.
He's creating a new person and a new creature. And so what that baggage eventually comes, it doesn't become part of your identity.
Exactly.
It's part of, at one point, an experience that you went through, but it doesn't become part of who you are.
Definitely.
I thought that was so good.
And I did mention, and I just want to highlight, because I think, you know, for some people, maybe they're in the church, like, oh, I don't feel like I have much of a past or whatever. Well, sometimes we live in the successes, and I, you know, and that's it, you know, the glory of yesterday, the success of yesterday, of what I did well yesterday, that we get so caught up in that we don't move on to what God has next. And so sometimes we're living in the past, and it's not we're living in the past of the bad baggage of life.
Right.
We're living in, like, oh man, this is awesome. And I hear this in church at times.
Oh,
I mean, you know, like, you know, man, all those, man, back in the day, you know, and it's okay to remember those things, and it's okay to celebrate what God did in the past. But sometimes I think some people get so caught up of, man, you remember when God moved like this, and you know, it was this song and this way, and we did these things, that they're missing out on the new work that he's doing today. And over and over, I just think about the pastor scripture. He says, behold, I'm doing a new thing, you know?
Yeah.
And can you perceive it? Like, he's like, can you even see it? And I think what he was saying there sometimes is you don't even see it sometimes because you're focused on the old thing.
Yeah.
Your past. And what I did in the past, that you can't perceive the new work that I'm doing today. And I think in the body of Christ, we need to be really careful, because I think sometimes we're holding on to the past, and we all have that tendency to do it, or to a past moment. Let's celebrate it. Let's rejoice in what God did. But let's go, God, I know you're doing something new today.
Absolutely. And then the last thing was the to have that proper perspective of the future.
Yeah. And, you know, and this kind of wraps up the mindset. You know, I'm not living for the here and now, that eternity is the goal of my heart. I'm a citizen of heaven. And so I'm living for a future kingdom. My goal is to help bring heaven down to earth in the here and now. And so then that becomes my mindset. Am I living for eternity? Am I living for the things that God has for me in the future? And so we focus on my purpose now. But know that the goal is to become like Jesus, and I'm focusing on eternity with him forever.
Yeah.
So
I was listening to a podcast yesterday, and my Matthew West podcast. Uh-huh. And he talked about how that this life here on earth is like the airport. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to stay at the airport too long.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to be left in the airport. Nobody wants, but the airport is just the place that gets us to and from.
Yeah.
You know, and basically, you know, that heaven is definite is has, you know, that this life we live on earth is like the airport. You know, it gets us, it's going to get us to heaven and to and from places here on earth and to and from destination that God wants us to go to, but it's not where we live. It's not where we stay, you know, that our reward is going to be in heaven.
That's
and
good.
That, you know, that we need to remember that. And he said it a lot better than I just did, but
that's awesome.
But you know, it was good. And I think that that's part of that kingdom mindset is to realize that we have so much more to look forward to with Christ, you know?
Yep.
And, you know, I think about, we've had a lot of loss in this world here lately and in the last year and a half, and a lot of people have been affected by that.
Exactly.
And to realize that, you know, that is that great reward that we set our mind to, that goal that we set our mind to make heaven our home, becomes so real to us when someone passes. And
exactly,
you know, and so I think that, you know,
we
all need to keep the focus, right?
Exactly.
Keep our focus, keep maintaining. I love that you said the C.S. Lewis quote, aim at heaven and you get earth thrown in.
Yep.
Aim at both and you get neither.
Yep.
You know, so it's definitely we are called to live on this earth and we are called to be lights on this earth. But we need to remember that our final destination is that heavenly home. So,
awesome.
But so we wrap up.
We are wrapping up this Sunday. And honestly, we're coming back a little bit to this concept of perspective. This is kind of a kingdom culture mindset. And then I want to narrow in on one kind of thing that I think our perspective needs to change in so that we can so we can live in the kingdom of God. So,
awesome. Yep, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. Well, hey, we're glad that you joined us today on Between the Lines. And we will look forward to seeing you on Sunday.
Yep.
I think it's going to be a beautiful weekend.
Awesome.
So enjoy your weekend this weekend and come back Sunday morning and join us here at Victory Hill.